Good afternoon, Council, and welcome to Special Governance and Priority Committee meeting regarding our presentations and capital operating budgets. We have a call to order, which apparently I did. We have the approval of the agenda, then the presentation, and then I think it's the best thing is to hear the presentation, ask questions, and then go from any motions from there. So with that, I need approval of the agenda, please.
I'll move the agenda.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried. Thank you very much. Brenda, Dwayne, Kate.
And
Gail. Brenda, please proceed.
Okay, so I'll just run us through, and it's a fairly short presentation. Start with the 2012 operating budget. This is where we started off, or ended off. I'll just bring us up to date in terms of where we left off at our last meeting on March 8th. So, as you know, we started with a 4.7% tax increase for 2012 in our approved five-year plan from last year. There was a number of increases to the budget, and then there's in order to meet the 3.5% target, there was a number of cuts that we brought forward. Those cuts from departments came to about the tax increase down to 4.65%, and then to bring us down to the 3.5%, this is what was proposed. Or we needed another $1.2 million cut, and this is what was proposed to meet that target. So a reduction in the capital levy of $950,000 and a reduction in the transfer to capital reserves of $250,000. So that brought us down to the 3.5% tax increase. A number of things have occurred since that time, since March 8th. The library budget, we've received the final library budget that will be going or being presented to GPC on April 5th for Council's approval. And fortunately, their budget, their finalized budget, is $68,000 less than what their preliminary budget that we had included in the plan. So that $68,000 could be used to either further reduce the city's tax increase by 0.06% down to 3.44%, or reduce the proposed reduction to the capital levy. Last Thursday, Council approved elimination of your internal catering for Council, GPC, and standing committees, which represents an ongoing budget savings of $12,000 per year, which could again be used to either reduce the city's tax increase or to reduce the proposed reduction to the capital levy. So again, this is just highlighting where we left off and where the capital reductions were proposed to come from. Engineering and Parks were asked to recommend only those programs that did not impact deferred maintenance or that created new assets and therefore added pressure to our operating budget for ongoing maintenance and upkeep, and if there was a lack of staff capacity to actually complete the work. And those were the reductions that were presented on March 6th. Some of the revised reductions, so on March 6th and March 8th, there was some discussion that Council had some questions or concerns about a number of the items, so we'll see on upcoming slides what other options were being put forward. But I just wanted to highlight here that some of the revised reductions on engineering's option two slides, in my opinion, do impact deferred maintenance, and I would not recommend. So this was the option one that was presented on March 6th from Engineering Public Works. And the two areas, as I recall, that there was council members had concerns with were the bicycle master plan implementation of $50,000 and I believe the bus shelter installation of $15,000. So engineering went and looked at how what other options they could come up with in terms of reducing other items in their capital plan to find another $65,000. So this is what they have proposed. The items that have an asterisk beside them are ones that they feel will actually impact future maintenance or planned maintenance, so hence our deferred maintenance. Parks, this was the reduction, that reductions that Parks proposed. And I believe there was concerns mostly around the greenways, cuts to the greenways plan. So Parks also went and they relooked at their all of their capital programs. And they've come up with an option two that's here. So what they've done is they've added back funding to greenways, park upgrades, and parks management plan, or a smaller reduction for there. And they've proposed, to offset that, they've proposed a further these reductions of $230,000, which are detailed in this slide. And this one, since there's so many changes with the parks one, we just listed them here for you. Suzanne also handed out two spreadsheets which outline in detail, a little bit more detail, what the proposed cuts are for engineering and parks, and I believe it also shows you what the beginning and ending balances will be. So this is recommendations that I put forward for council to consider, that $65,000 of the library budget savings be used to increase the capital levy and add back the following proposed annual cuts to the engineering cuts and for capital, and that's the bus shelters and the bicycle master plan. So rather than going with Public Works and Engineering's option two, that we fund these items through from savings from the library budget. So other than those changes, that I'd recommend that the engineering's option one reductions be approved. And also recommending that the $12,000 budget savings from elimination of council's catering budget and the remaining $3,000 from the library budgets for a total of $15,000 be used again to increase the capital levy and add funding to the greenways plan. And then the last option here is that the parks option two be approved with the exception of that change that would have been. So again, at the end of the meeting today, this is would be the goal, is that we that I receive approval and principles for the operating budget and the capital budget, and ideally preliminary direction on acceptable tax increase for 2013 to 2016 for preparation of the financial plan bylaw. Although I do appreciate that this would be, we'll get into more in-depth discussion on that, I expect, during council's priority sessions. So next steps, this is just for the timelines. We'll have the required public budget presentation on April 5th. Tax policy review, as you know, is also going forward on April 5th. Then we'll finalize tax rates, tax rate options for April 19th, and then the bylaws for both the budget and tax rate bylaws will must be adopted before May 15th, so they could go to council April 26th, and then final approval on May 10th. Next steps after that is a presentation on existing service levels, capacity, and key initiatives, and direction on acceptable tax increase for the remainder of the five-year plan. Also a strategy to permanently reduce the budget to meet council's targeted tax increases and the council priority setting. And I understand that these dates are being finalized now or looked at for near the end of April. During 2012, staff will also be undertaking the following: a review of the start, review of parking revenue, review of Crystal Pool, and the plan is to also reprioritize the 20-year capital. And that's the presentation, and we have, I'm happy to answer any questions, and both Dwayne and Kate are here to also answer specific questions regarding parks and parks.
Thank you very much. One of the things which finding you probably would answer more from Kate Friars, but council was sort of looking at the Beacon Hill Park, getting rid of the Beacon Hill Park transportation plan. I think it was $100,000 a year for 5 years. And my understanding that you've gone back and said, okay.
Actually,
we need that cut. We need that to reprioritize that towards the greenways, which allows us to move forward if we wish, finishing up, is it Cecilia Ravine Greenway, and moving forward on the Gonzales-Chandler pathway.
That's correct. Following discussions from council at your March 6th meeting, we went back and actually started from a baseline now of minus $600,000. And we went back and revisited each item. And so hence why we were looking through your comments to take money from the Beacon Hill Management Transportation Plan and put it to items that had become, that you shared with us as a concern. And so we, you will note in this list on page 17 that we bumped up the funding for the Greenways Plan and some park upgrades and rearranged the overall financing of our whole capital program, minus $600,000.
Okay, so just, you know, before we get into option one, option two, all that sort of stuff, just an awareness that, and I'm trying to figure out how to do that, because before we even got option one and two, it's sort of like, I just want to say, so the Beacon Hill Transportation Management Plan, I think the indication is we can do a temporary closure for about 15,000 or?
What's remaining in there is about $25,000. We would implement a temporary plan should council approve this option. It has to come back to you for approval. But we would be implementing temporary closures to try it out over the next year and then revisit the whole option what kind of road closures could we implement and revisit it in a future year.
So if we wanted to stay with option one under the parks plan, I just want to make sure that we've captured that, that we have that capacity to recognize that there is nothing in Beacon Hill other than that 25,000 you said. But it allows us to, but I just want to make sure we're bumping up the Greenways plan, but taking it from the other one. The takeaway isn't reflected in this. That's the difficulty that I'm having.
If you look at this spreadsheet, if you note in under Greenways, which is about halfway down the page, the original budget was $260,000. The option one reduction was about $110,000, leaving $150,000. Now we're proposing actually that our capital budget for Greenways be about $353,000. That will allow us to complete the Cecilia Ravine Road Greenways option, as well as have money set aside for if council chooses to go ahead with Gonzales Chandler proposal. There are sufficient funds in there to do that work.
Thank you. That was clarification I needed on that, because I know we had originally was saying we were going to have a discussion about that 100,000. Council, I wanted to let you know that that's where it is. Do it that way.
Thank you. Councilor Eisen. Was the balance, the 600,000 versus the 300,000, the balance between the two departments assessed at all? In terms of greater, I guess, parity between sharing the burden more equally?
We have done that, like, over the last few years, that there's been significant cuts to the engineering public works capital. Again, we stuck with the looking at the principles of deferred maintenance and what's due in capacity. And so from that perspective,
the 350,000 was the number that was appropriate for engineering.
Just to make a comment, last year I think we cut near $1 million out of the public works engineering budget, so that was substantially more than parks last year.
Okay. And then the last question for our director of parks, I guess the council's motion regarding Chandler Gonzales referred to the 2012 budgeting process, which I guess is nearly complete, and I know there's challenges with staffing resources and preparing reports, but I'm just curious. It looks like we're at risk of not meeting that deadline, so when can we expect to?
The report will be coming to council at your GPC meeting on April 19th, I believe.
Oh, excellent.
It is,
okay.
With the various options to consider.
Perfect. Okay, thank you very much.
But they've place marked the funding to be able to actually do it if council wants to do it.
Great.
If we choose not to do it, then we could probably either allow it to go to surplus or something like that, but it's there for us.
Sure.
I think they've better heard that we want to make it happen.
Yeah, well, even if referring back to the 09 motion, it said subject to budgetary allocation, which appears that it's now taking place. So there may be a non-decision for council to make.
Maybe an easy decision for council. Which is, we're looking forward to a few easy decisions once in a while. Councilor Hill.
I have two questions. One, this skipping ahead to the end, actually, in terms of the recommendations, the 2013 to 2016, those are the remaining 4 years of the five-year plan, is that right?
Yes.
So that doesn't reflect a potential desire to move to a three-year budgeting cycle?
No, it doesn't. I think I had in one of my earlier presentations had just focused on the next 2 or 3 years, but we do have to implement a five-year plan, and we're required to do five-year budgeting.
Right, and by May 15th, we have to approve a tax increase, like a kind of a guess at our tax increase until 2016, is that correct?
That's correct. So the council have two options. What we could do is focus on 2012 and whatever is decided today, and then let the 2013 to 2016 be whatever works out to, like the 4.5, or
yeah.
And then work on that during council priorities, and just give us, and then council can provide staff with direction going forward. Or you could say, no, you want to reflect in this year's five-year plan what your desired increase is. Of course, we wouldn't be able to do any work to determine what that is, but we could make some arbitrary changes between, say, general government and police or that sort of thing.
Great, thank you. And my other question is about the new assessed revenue. So on page 4 of the presentation, for 2012, it shows new assessed revenue estimated at zero. And then on page 8, it shows it estimated at 500,000, which is what I think is what you were expecting. So which is it?
It's 500,000.
Okay, great.
And I can explain why it shows it like this. That's because we changed the policy, financial sustainability policy, that reflected that new assessment revenue would go toward transfers to capital. And we'll be bringing that policy again forward. So what we've done going forward is showing the 500,000 as new assessment revenue, and then a decision can be made in terms of how much of that goes toward transfer funds.
Great. Because I just wouldn't want us to show zero new expected revenue, because I think that sends a very strange message to the development community, like, don't expect anything that's going to happen in 2012. Okay, thanks for that clarification.
Let's start working through some stuff here, folks. I think that probably the best thing we can do right at this time would be probably to introduce the motion that Councillor Aalto wants to bring forward, because it's going to help clarify some of the four points that we need to work on. Right? I think just put it, just start working that on the table.
Okay.
Okay.
Well, following up, and I won't belabor the issue because we had a great discussion last Thursday night, but following up from that, in the spirit of trying to capture the opportunities that unexpectedly came forward, with that being the $68,000 from the library budget, and also including the $12,000 that we saved from packing your own lunches, etc., I wanted to propose a further motion that suggests that we, in fact, reduce the 2010 proposed tax lift from 3.5% to 3.25%, and reduce the proposed by reducing the proposed 2012 budget by $259,349 by taking the following budgetary actions, and that is that we reduce the city's contracted services budget by $30,000, and that we reduce the City of Victoria's share of the proposed 2012 police budget by $150,000. With suggestions for savings in areas coming from eliminating their projected increases from both professional fees and office supplies, and reducing by 50% their projected expenditures for miscellaneous, which would total about $150,000. And then also allocating the $12,000 saved from eliminating our council catering, and the $68,000 from the reduced GVPL budget, and having all of that associated towards reducing the tax lift from 3.5 to 3.25%. And I would place that motion on the floor.
Do you have a copy of that?
Yes.
I didn't see it myself.
No. There's one copy, but we should probably get more. And the reason why I wanted to put that on the table is it sort of directly addresses the $65,000 from the library budget, which is recommendation one, but encompasses it all. So, council, comments on the motion at this time? Councillor Isaac, Councillor Young.
I like the spirit of it. I have a question maybe for Mr. Woodland. My understanding of the police budget is that we can reject entire line items rather than rewrite allocation. So how, I guess, would Councillor Alto or Mr. Woodland view this as fitting within that statutory regime?
Well, in fact, there are three precise line items that have been identified in the motion. The reason it's phrased the way it is because we want to make sure that what we're addressing is our share of what we're paying for the police budget. But the specifics of the motion actually suggest three specific reductions, $78,099 from professional fees, $15,000 from office supplies, and $56,250 from their miscellaneous expenditures. So they are identified line by line.
It does also, but it says suggested, so it gives them an opportunity to say, here's the ones we identify.
Which is our responsibility.
Which is our responsibility under it.
If they choose to do something else, that's up to them.
They want to come back and say, we actually think this might be better, it allows that. So it's more of a working together motion, but certainly working together to help you reduce $150,000 motion. But it does mean, technically, I think it allows us to argue either way. Other questions on the motion?
Well, yeah, I'd just like to hear from staff with regard to the legalities and also in terms of the way in which we can impose cuts and what the options of the police board are, and also with regard to the likely reaction of Esquimalt. I know that they came forward with some specific cuts last year that we had some difficulty with. And I'd just like to know what happens if, for whatever reason, the police board and the police staff are more persuasive with them than they may be with us with regard to those. What does that mean? Are we saying we're not going to pay our share, but Esquimalt can still pay its share? I'm just a little concerned with bringing forward a specific cut like this at this stage of the game.
So how that has worked in the past and in terms of the cuts and then the impact on the two municipalities is that the reason that the wording would be that we look to reducing the city's share by $150,000, the impact of that is it's actually a $176,000 cut to the police budget. And that the city share is 84.62% or whatever, and Esquimalt is the remaining, or 84.6%, sorry, and Esquimalt would get the benefit of the remaining cut. So that's how we've done, unless Councillor Young is very specific in terms of them. I know was it last year that Esquimalt said they didn't want to fund officers for Ellis Street, which is something that the city had already agreed to, but for a general, more of a generalized cut, both municipalities would get the benefit of that. In terms of the legalities, we've been advised that the Police Act states councils can only look at line items. I think it's a gray area in terms of the interpretation of that, and in speaking with the police department. I don't think anyone believes that the intent is that councils would have to go say you can't cut your office supplies budget. I think the intent is likely more broader than that in terms of you don't want to have those officers at Ellis Street, or you don't want to do a certain thing, or you don't want a certain coverage for an event or that. So in terms of going forward, I think the more generalized approach is more would be easier for the police department as it is for the city for council to give direction in terms of what cut you want. So if you provide direction to the police board stating that you want the city of Victoria wants to reduce their requisition or their cost for police services by $150,000. That reflects a $176,000 cut for them. You can outline areas where you believe they can look at, but I think to be effective, it would be easier for the police department to look at where they can find that amount of money. So if council gives specific direction in terms of the dollar amount, it would be easier for the police department to come up with appropriate cuts, looking at the options. But it may be very difficult for them to cut in one of the areas specified, because maybe they have, it may relate to, say, an agreement that they're required to have, like through Prime BC, or, you know, it may not be possible in that line item to be able to do that. But if they know the council's direction is the dollars, then they should be able to do it.
So should our recommendation be a dollar cut or a line item cut?
Your
I'm sorry, I did, the answer was so long.
Sorry,
Jeff. Can you just say, should we be putting the recommendation as a dollar cut?
Brendan, you can tell me if I got this wrong. If the police board doesn't like our recommendation, then they can go to police services and say they disagree with this recommendation. That is the process that Esquimalt did when they didn't want to fund those two officers at the Ellis Street. That is a technical and legal prescription that they can do. My understanding is, through this motion, that we've captured both the spirit and the intent of the act, which essentially says, here's some line items we suggest that you cut, but we also allow the flexibility for them to say, okay, we recognize we have to cut $150,000, let's go see where we can find it, and if we're better served than out of photocopying, then so be it, we'll come back. My understanding in conversation with the officers, as opposed to the police board, that this is something that they would prefer, given the direction, and something that they will take to the police board and essentially say, this is what council wants to do. We're going to have to find a way to make it happen. So I just want to tell, so legally, they could take us to police services, and police services could argue, but technically, this is what the way they kind of wanted the motion. Thank you. Stevens?
In terms of the police services' role in all this, because I've had many conversations with them, they will look at that and say, those specific cuts, they will look at it and say, would this impact policing in Victoria or Esquimalt? And I think would probably only interject if they believe public safety would be at risk.
Any further questions on the current motion?
Councillor Madoff?
My main concern, having heard that background, is our relationship with Esquimalt and whether or not we have communicated with them. As well, and how we would do that. I mean, they may be thinking of something similar, and then you've got these two separate requests going in. So I'm just wondering, because we share this policing, what we're doing to make sure that they feel that they have been appropriately consulted, informed, whatever word you care to use. Because I'm just concerned that just by doing this, it can send us off in two different directions.
We have not had a chance to speak to or talk to Ms. Weimel. This is something that has been just in the making the last couple mm-hmm. last day. My anticipation is that Esquimalt is also looking for ways to reduce, and so they would welcome this motion because it reduces their amount as well.
Well, I'd love to assume that they will, but I think if I was to support this, there would have to be a subject to, and that would involve that conversation occurring at least as a courtesy with Esquimalt. If we move forward with our policing issues, I think that would be really helpful.
Well, Esquimalt would always have the option to continue to fund their 15% of these cuts. I don't understand what you're saying.
I'm talking about a respectful process with Esquimalt. I'm not talking about what we're able to do, what we're able to do under the Police Act and all of those things. That we, this can be totally legal and appropriate. I'm talking about our relationship with Esquimalt and what is appropriate to do, even just as a courtesy, I think would be appropriate to let them know. And I think it would be useful to have that captured here, that that's actually a request, if council supports that, that that communication would take place so that we're not having two solitudes again.
Absolutely. So what you're asking is an undertaking that if this passes, that we'll phone Esquimalt and let them know what we're thinking. That's what we're talking
about.
Councilor Young?
Well, I think it would also be important to give the information that I think we heard, which is, although we're suggesting cutting photocopying or whatever it was, if the police find that it is more effective to cut something else, then they can do that. But that we are required, I take it, by the way in which we can approve or not approve the budget to specify individual line items and to clarify that, because I'm pretty sure that they would have different line items that they would intend to identify.
Yeah, I just want to understand a little bit more about what Councillor Madoff is suggesting. So I'm prepared to support this motion as it stands, but I'm not, and I think sure we should call a SquamAlt if it passes, but I don't think we should build a SquamAlt into the motion, because what I understood from the Director of Finance is that they will also benefit from this. And if they are suggesting some ideas to the police that should be cut, then we will also benefit from that. So I see it as a mutual benefit. I'm not sure that I understand how a SquamAlt would be negatively impacted by having to pay less.
I didn't suggest that they be negatively impacted by paying less. I was suggesting that our relationship may be harmed by not having, giving them the courtesy of letting them know what we're considering. It's a big difference between negatively impacting them and the courtesy of communicating with them.
Absolutely.
Communication is our main issue and problem with the SquamAlt. And here's a chance to really be connected and communicative with them. And I think there's an enormous value to that. And so to me, whether it's part of the motion, that instruction, and again, I think, as Councillor Young has said, to explain if this is supported, why it's worded the way it is, what we can do under the Police Act, why it's been done in the way it is, because we certainly didn't support what they were suggesting in terms of budget cuts, and that's not supported under the Act. So I think it's an opportunity for education on both sides, as we're learning how we can bring forward motions like this, but also just to provide that link with them and let them know what our deliberations and considerations have been.
Okay, any other speakers?
Is it possible to distribute it around to the motion?
Yes, maybe, sir. Charlie, third joke.
No, I was just gonna add that I support Councillor Madoff's recommendation. I think it, in the spirit of respect.
Could you clarify with me what you think Councillor Madoff said?
So taking the motion that Councillor Aalto has put forward, but also adding to the motion that we communicate this intent to the SquamAlt. And I think it's just, as Councillor Madoff says, it's more just being respectful and saying that in our deliberations, we recognize that whether it's positively or negatively affected SquamAlt, we want them to be aware that it's a partnership. That we should notify them. And by putting it in the motion, acknowledges that.
Yeah. I wasn't quite sure if we were saying we won't do the cuts if the SquamAlt doesn't want them.
No, I don't know if I
said that. No, I'm just trying to capture that.
No, I didn't hear that.
Okay,
no,
so
I heard it just communication.
Is that the desire? That we should have a wording for the amendment? Or is Councillor Aalto, are you wanting to amend your original motion or change your original motion, or do you want an amendment?
Well, I would be happy with what I understood the mayor to suggest was an undertaking that he would execute, that he would, should this pass, that he would advise a SquamAlt at the earliest opportunity. I don't personally think there's a requirement for an amendment to. I'm not, if everybody else thinks there should be, I'm okay with that too. But I don't think it's necessary.
And we'd like that too, which is, advises SquamAlt of our intention to reduce in these areas.
Sure.
Well, I heard two different things. I heard our staff say, we can only propose individual items. We tell them, we want you to cut your photocopying budget by $30,000. Okay, that comes to them and they find out that of their $35,000 photocopying budget, $30,000 is cut. So they're now unable to lay charges or do some vital function. So they come back to us and say, that's not a good idea, but we have an alternative suggestion and here's what it is. Okay, I think that is a pretty important kind of thing, because when a SquamAlt said to us, we want to cut those two constables who are over there on at our new
Rock Bay
Landing, that wasn't, we just want to cut that amount of money. That was a pretty specific thing. So we're not meaning that. I think it is incumbent on us to explain that to them.
Yes.
And explain why we are suggesting these cuts and invite them to join with us if they feel that this kind of signal to the police department is appropriate.
So in the in an effort to resolve this impasse, I'm going to suggest that the second part of the motion, which is pertaining to the reductions in the police budget, have an additional few words added to the end. So after his last reference to the miscellaneous fees, that there be an additional phrase that suggests this, that we reduce the Victoria share as it's defined, and that we advise the Township of Esquimalt of the substance and rationale of this motion.
Ms. Stevens.
I think, through your worship, that I think one of the points might be that that the city would send a letter to the board suggesting that if alternative cuts in this amount were more palatable, the city would be amenable to those considerations.
I mean, I think the intent of the motion is traditionally what we say to our staff here is, this is where we want to go. Go find it. Unfortunately, the way the Police Act is set up is you're not allowed to give that general direction. You're only allowed to say, no kibbles and bits for the dogs, right? I mean, those are the difficulties. So what we're trying to do is meet the spirit of both ways of doing it, of saying, under the Act, here's some areas where we're allowed to cut. And if you want to come back to us and say line items, we put them in there. But we said these are suggestions, which allows them to capture the spirit of Councillor Young's intention, which is to say, if you found some better place or give it to us, then let us know. But ultimately, the end is to reduce the budget by $150,000. And so, that hopefully is what the intent of the motion is, to get the best and to a certain extent to assume that the police board and the police department are our allies and they're going to work with us, as opposed to working against us and running down to the police services and saying, we want you to sue them and order them to give us the money that we want. So that there's some assumptions there, obviously, but I think that they're reasonable assumptions. Councillor Helps?
And the bigger picture
Go ahead, Elspeth.
So the bigger picture is that we're not nickel and diming the police department or anyone else for fun, but the whole spirit of Councillor Alto's motion is to signal to our taxpayers that we hear them and we're making a serious attempt to take seriously the need to reduce city spending. And so this 0.25% is being cobbled together out of easy areas at this last minute point. So that's just wanting to put the bigger picture on the table. It's not just about the police department and these line items. I know that's the way we need to make the motion. It's about what we're trying to signal, both for this year and going forward.
I apologize. I missed Councillor Coleman. That's a first speaker, and then I'll come back to Councillor Isaac and Olto.
Thank you. I have no problem supporting the motion with its intent and the discussion it's had. I wouldn't go so far as to say we're cobbling it out of easy areas. I think we got rid of dealing with easy areas some time ago as we were bringing it down from the 4.7. So this is more substantive in that respect. I am fascinated by the passion around the table that I think would have been helped last Thursday if we include the minutes from the standing committees, not just the recommendations. So I think that's as a governance issue, because I think a lot of the underlying thought and discussion that had gone on at the standing committee, not specific to this motion but the one we dealt with on Thursday, would have been dealt with if people had had a chance to look at the minutes. So we might need to think about that in the future. It, I suspect, doesn't just apply to the corporate services standing committee but all standing committees, because I think that would be helpful. So I would ask that. But as we move on, I think I'd like to congratulate Councillor Alto for her perspicacity in sticking at this one, because I think it is a necessary focus that we keep on trying to bring the tax lift down. So thank you for that, and I know it's painful at times, and poor old Brenda goes,
sorry,
oh,
Brenda.
Come on. But it is worthwhile, and I think that this direction is absolutely correct, and I think Councillor Madoff's suggestion that we always keep in the back of our minds appropriate discussion and conversation with our partners is particularly useful, but I'm happy to move forward with this.
Thank you. I have Isaac and Alto. I will laugh because you reminded me of something that Director Hicks said, actually to Director Isaac at the time, which is, you've now given me three words I have to go home and look up. So thank you for whatever that
perspicacity. It's a good one.
I couldn't tell if you were insulting her or complimenting her.
No, it was a compliment.
Is it a good? Okay, it's a good thing.
She's the pit bull of fiscal reality. How's that?
That works
for me. I don't
like
being specific.
Ben?
The intent of the squad is to consult, I guess, rather than just advise them of a decision that's done. And could emphasize in the motion that this is just a GPC recommendation, and that there's still final adoption at council. So the wording could, it says that we will notify.
Advise.
We can say notify prior to final adoption, which would open the door to them weighing in if they so chose. Mm-hmm. Just maybe emphasize Councilor Madoff before I draw Joe's points.
Thank you. Okay, on the main motion, as slightly amended, go ahead, Councilor Alto.
I just want to add a couple of quick things, not to belabor it. thank you for first the guest today, that's really cool. The reason that the police portion of this is phrased the way it is has been discussed not because we want to particularly focus on an aspect of the police budget for any nefarious reason. It was really a sense of trying to match what I understood to be the regulatory requirements of having to identify line by line and wanting to focus on administrative costs, which would not in any way affect the quality of policing or their ability to do their jobs, and I think that's really important to state. There's no intent here to try and undermine police services or their ability to perform well as they do. There is certainly an attempt to bring into the same budgetary belt-tightening exercise that all of us are going through the police services budget so that we can actually make sure that all of us are pulling in the same direction at the same time. And the sense behind this is certainly been one of an effort of many people over a variety of weeks and months. And I think the important thing to remember is that although this is another small step, just like eliminating the catering was a small step, this is a small step in the context of the whole budget. It is a step which allows us to further reduce the tax lift and the burden on our residents by another 0.25%, and although 3.25 is still not good enough, I think it does signal that we're all cognizant of the fact that everyone is struggling, we are too, and we're going to move in this direction as far as we can, as quickly as we can. And I'm looking forward to our discussions in the coming years about where we can go after this. So I thank you for your patience and your advice, many of you, and I look forward to your thoughts on this.
Thank you. On the motion, all those in favor? Opposed? And opposed? Carried. Okay, so that sort of takes care of the issue of number one, which is, so the $65,000 from the library budget will be used to decrease, right?
68.
So now what happens to the bus shelters and bus Michael plan?
I think that would be exception.
Yep.
Good.
Just want to be clear on that. Mm-hmm. So let me just get that answer from staff, and then we'll go to Councilor Eisen.
So we're back to the original option one, as presented, is on March 6th, which includes cutting the bus shelter installation by $15,000 and the bicycle master plan by $50,000, or option two, which is to retain the funding for those two items and reduce the options as put forward on the slide.
Okay, so these are engineering and not in parks.
Right.
Okay. Thank you. Okay.
Well, not related specifically to the capital plan, but more in the vein of Councilor Alto's motion. I have the motions that I circulated this morning to council, which I'd like to put on the table in the interest of further modest savings.
Could we get a hard copy? I mean, I didn't have a chance to print it, so I'm sorry.
I can circulate this, if I can read it out first. So one is based on new information received from an organization that receives city funds and is asking for further savings. The second, so I'll read them out. The first motion, be it resolved that the grant allocation of $50,000 to the Greater Victoria Chamber of Commerce be removed from the 2012 budget, recognizing the Chamber's request for, quote, more moderate tax increases and potential savings to businesses and residential taxpayers. I guess maybe these are separate motions, so I'll start with that one.
Councilor Joe, Councilor Young, Councilor Cole.
Is the $50,000 different than the money we get for the economic development? Or
that
is
that, that is that economic is that's the economic development.
That's what I thought. Yep. I just wanted to make sure I was clear on what that money was.
Thank you, Councilor Young.
Well, it certainly raises some ideas. Some of our community organizations are occasionally critical of our actions as well. And we could maybe start cutting back their budgets just as a recognition that we don't like what they're saying. We could we could go farther and start withdrawing advertising from newspapers that printed comments that were critical about our budget stance. I guess that that's a road I don't think we should be going down.
Thank you, Your Worship. I appreciate the intent to try and find savings. However, I think that this is absolutely the wrong direction. It's understanding the history of why we worked so hard for so many years and bordering on decades in this region to get economic development properly funded. I recognize that our 50K then gets matched up. I think the Chamber of Commerce actually put 65 into it now.
15.
And Saanich puts in 30. I mean, the reason we did this was to recognize that part of the necessary vibrancy to this area is economic sustainability, and this is about attraction of business. If we pull it back, I suspect the VDCA ceases to exist in fairly short order. We stop doing the development work that's necessary for at least half of our tax base. It's absolutely the wrong direction, and it's difficult when we're asked to react to this on sort of 2 hours' notice. So I didn't have a chance to muster thoughts, but I think I couldn't possibly support this because I think it is one of the areas that allows us to develop at a nominal cost some of the economic vibrancy that we're actually discussing and trying to foster more of. So I can't support this as a motion.
Councillor Helms.
Yeah, I can't support it either for the same reason that I couldn't support an increase in funding to the Downtown Activity Center. My understanding is that the grants to the Chamber and the grants to everybody else are under consideration for the new Civic Investment Strategy, and I think for 2012 we maintain the status quo, and then next year if the Civic Investment Strategy is, if Council adopts it, then the Chamber applies for their $50,000 just like everybody else applies and has to show value for their money. So I can't support the motion in the same reason I couldn't support another very different motion.
Can I speak to it?
I have a call question. On the motion to have $50,000 cut to the Chamber of Commerce, all those in favor? Councillor Isaac in favor? Opposed? Gary? Thank you. Everybody's opposed except for Isaac. Councillor Isaac, you have a second motion you want to put?
I guess I have to speak to it right away.
Yes.
And I'll add also that we had no notice that the previous motion that passed unanimously. I did provide colleagues with about 4 hours notice. Apologies that there wasn't more, but there was new information. Be it resolved that the city's expenditure on Christmas decorations be adjusted to $20,000 in 2012.
From what?
I believe it's in the neighborhood of $80,000, but it's not in the wording of my motion. And to speak to this, I think over time, I think we should review whether we spend funds on holiday decorations in the interests of, I think, the separation of church and state. I don't personally identify with the Christian faith, and it has, as a member of a minority group, it has always rubbed me the wrong way when there's publicly funded nativity scenes and Christmas decorations. And so I think this motion acknowledges that perhaps a transition in the interests of multiculturalism, and that people, I think, are welcome to celebrate, and there's various ways to celebrate individuals' faiths, but I disagree in principle with public funds being devoted to favor a group, even if it happens to be a majority group. So I think this acknowledges that by containing the spending, still allowing for there to be seasonal decorations in Centennial Square for at least one more year, but making them a bit more modest, maybe perhaps a tree or two rather than tons of trees and buildings, and basically $80,000 being allocated for lights that go up for 3 or 4 weeks in a time of fiscal restraint. So that's the motivation.
So just to give you some information on what this account is for, it's not just for Christmas decorations. It really is broader. It's entitled Seasonal Decorations Account. It's used for a variety of decorations, including the Summer Banner Program, which we do spend $30,000 to $40,000 every 2 years for this, the Chinese New Year's Lantern and Lighting Program, summer markets, decorations, and strategic enhancement and replacement of some of the aging Christmas decoration elements. It also assisted with the purchase of 150 anniversary banners for the downtown Beacon Hill Park. The upgrading of the lights in Centennial Square fountain was drawn for this account as a feature for the Christmas festivities this year. So it goes beyond just Christmas lights, it's really our seasonal decorations for most of the downtown.
Thank you to Council for the clarification. I did want to also echo that the 80,000, which I believe has been consistent, I know for at least the last 5 years. And one of the reasons why I'm aware of this budget, it is a budget that a lot of it is partnered with the DDBA. Mm-hmm. And you know, being clear that it's not just going to the Christmas season, but the Chinese New Year's, even Halloween, the lights in Chinatown, there's the banners, which we have all around the city and downtown, that we've had for every year for many years. But also recognizing that it's part of economic development. And one of the reasons why the DVBA put more emphasis, and the city, and emphasis in the winter holidays, is to draw people to the downtown for the shopping season. And I think it just supports the partnership. So when you look at 80,000, if we look at least 15,000 to 20,000 going just to the banner program itself, it doesn't leave that much for all the others. And I know, even being at the table, when we look at the winter holidays, we've definitely have gone away from stressing that it's the Christmas season, and the comments that you've made of what the Christmas season may mean to some people. But looking at it as a holiday season and bringing families in, whether they're shopping or not shopping, or just enjoying the winter season down to downtown, has been something that's been, you know, part of the agenda or part of the discussions. So I would support the decrease for this budget.
Councillor Young, Councillor Coleman.
I believe that we have pretty much gotten away from any specifically Christmas type, although you used the word Christmas, I know, Dwayne, as I recall, we're pretty much trying to stay away from anything that's specifically Christmas, as opposed to, I mean, we haven't gotten quite to pagan Christmas trees yet, but
you're correct. The extent of it is the Christmas lights, but it's more for a seasonal festivity. So you're right. There's nothing specific that is for Christmas itself.
So we'll try and work on our terminology to get away from the word. But I agree that we should try and be as multi-ethnic as possible, recognizing that that is when people shop, and which is kind of the driving force.
Thank you. Not multi-ethnic, but multi-faith, I think.
yes.
Just to be technically correct.
Yes.
And we need to be very careful when we talk about the separation of church and state. It's to make sure no one church or denomination within a faith community controls the levers of government. I don't think, and I think one of the false arguments that is out there has been that it means divorcing of governance from faith communities, and I don't think that's the case. So I think it's about all faith communities. And I was saying when you sent this before, I'm a big fan of a Hasidic carol that comes from Peter, Paul, and Mary, called "Light One Candle," which went with their Christmas concert, although by any other faith. I mean, I think it's about embracing Hanukkah, I think it's about embracing Kwanzaa, that there's a whole range of things. And
solstice,
absolutely. So I have no problem, again, with this expenditure, because it talks about celebrating all the faiths in the context of an economically vibrant downtown, which is what it was there for, not just to the Christmas period, which is my tradition. So I can't vote for this one either.
I would be able to support this motion if I had more information about all of the things that Director Palanchuk read out, what the line items are. But I think if this motion passed, it would actually have unintended consequences in terms of what Councillor Isett is proposing, and which I think would be good, which is that we could not only draw on partnerships, but actually look to the private sector to hang banners and put up Christmas lights. You know, if they want to have a little sign that says "Save on Foods Christmas Light Display" or whatever, then that is something that maybe the city should get out of and the private sector could get into. But I don't have enough information to just randomly take $20,000 from somewhere at this point.
All those in favor of the motion? Councillor Isaac? All those opposed? Everyone else is opposed? Get the list. Thank you. Carry on.
One last one.
Okay.
It's an addendum in anticipation of that motion not being successful. Be it resolved that the city's annual Christmas decorations or annual seasonal decorations budget be expended in proportion to the religious affiliation of city residents as reported in the latest available census. Be it further resolved that an amount proportionate to the percentage of residents reporting no religion be transferred to the city's capital reserve fund.
Do you have a map on this?
It's just saying that I think rather than automatically, but the fact is we transform the sequoia tree into a Christmas tree. We could say it's not a Christmas tree, but that is a Christmas tree. No other religions that I know of celebrate their trees in such a way in late December. So the idea is if we're going to expend public funds, they should be expended proportionately to the ethnicity of our population. And if there's atheists out there, then that should be a savings, I believe, to the taxpayer. It's, I guess, again, a matter of principle, and I would say.
I want to make sure that we're a city open and inclusive to everyone, and certainly we spend, we're a city that's open and inclusive to everyone, and certainly we do spend money on what you can choose to call Christmas or festivities, you can call it holiday festivities, or many others. We spend money on the Heavenly Lights, which is in Chinatown, which is a totally different faith, and we have a huge celebration around our Chinese spring New Year, Qingming Kuai La. We support India Fest, we support in our bandshells, in our parks, we support all our different faiths and many of our growing ethnic diversities in different ways. And so to a certain extent, I think we're highlighting that this is for Christmas, but in so doing, we're not highlighting all the other things that we do around festivals and stuff. So I guess what I'm saying is I hear what you're saying, but it's one of those ones where to treat everyone equally doesn't mean you treat them all the same. There's different ways that they come out and how they manifest. And that's a lot of work, and I think we do an amazing job reflecting the multicultural nature of our community. Okay.
Well said. Thank you. And Isaac, I won't ever wait in my...
Vicky, please. Vicky. Thank you, Vicky. Thank you, Vicky.
Help him out, okay? The pickle's really high effective.
Vicky, thanks, Vicky. Does anyone else want to speak on this motion, or can I just...
I'm trying to remember the financial implications of
the second.
Yeah.
I guess the point I would throw out there is that...
Do you want me to read it out?
Yeah.
Can you read it?
It's headed Christmas decorations.
I'll change it to seasonal.
Be it resolved that the city's annual seasonal decorations budget be expended in proportion to the religious affiliation of city residents as reported in the latest available census data. Be it further resolved that an amount proportionate to the percentage of residents reporting no religion be transferred to the city's capital reserve fund. Well, I'm just wondering.
How far do we benefit from calling the question?
Yes,
please. Young, you have the floor. I cannot call the question until you start.
Please finish.
Okay.
Thank you.
The Sermon on the Mount.
Okay.
Come on.
Okay. There are so many things I could.
Me too. I want to
know what the no whether there isn't a suitable no religion decoration, type of decoration, and whether those, I mean, and it, no, I'm going to stop talking.
if I could call the question on the motion by Councillor Eisen. All those in favor? Councillor Eisen in favor. Are those opposed? Everyone else is opposed. Carry. Thank you.
I want the motion.
It didn't have a prayer.
I want to
see
that
emotion. Councillor Helps.
Yeah. I'd like to put option two on the table as it's presented to us up here. Keeping the bus shelters and master plan. Anyways, I don't need to say it because it's there. Brings us back to...
If Public Works option one, ongoing reduction, be approved, I think...
I said option two. I'm putting option two.
Oh, I'm sorry. I was looking at number two as opposed to option two.
Yeah, this is option two, yeah.
I'd like to keep bus shelters and bicycles.
The question I have is...
The asterisk.
You want to keep bus shelters and you want to reduce these other ones.
motion? Yes, that's the
option. Okay, this option is on the table. Speaking on this option, Councillor Coleman.
Question.
Page number on this, isn't it? Somebody 14?
Our question, is this a small example of what got us originally into the issue of infrastructure deficits? Because we're not putting in new, we are now saying we're putting in new facilities or new benefits, but they will have ongoing operational issues. We are cutting back on maintenance and replacement of things like storm drains. Is this just a micro version of infrastructure deficit first phase? That's my concern, and I need some guidance on it.
My concern is that these are related to existing infrastructure, so existing assets, so we're deferring maintenance on these things.
Thank you, Councillor. I'm certainly sympathetic to both of the items for the $65,000, but the deferred maintenance, increasing the deferred maintenance for the underground and invisible items, I think is not the right way to go. So.
Okay, Councillor Hobbs, and then we'll go for all the questions.
Well, I just want to be clear. What I heard at the very first capital budget presentation, or I guess operating, when I asked, because I was alarmed for the very same reasons that both Councillor Young and Councillor Coleman have expressed of this creating this ongoing infrastructure deficit. However, and I asked very specifically of Director Warner, are these ongoing cuts? Is it forever? And she said, well, yes, but, you know, until we change the five-year plan or we do the budget for next year. So what it really will be, if we do our job well, is that we don't spend $33,000 on storm drains in 2012, but that we are going to look comprehensively at the city's operating and capital budgets, and that these, in reality, if we do our job well, won't be ongoing cuts. It'll simply be for 1 year, just like everything else, until we kind of get our house in order, get the asset management framework that's coming to us for infrastructure. So I don't see this as cutting storm drains forever or $33,000 forever. I see it as 1 year. And at the same time, we continue to have alternate transportation as a priority, and that needs to be funded again. So it's not, I don't see it as ongoing. I see it as for this year, and then we regroup.
Question for Mr. Kalinchak. What is fire preemption of $15,000?
Fire preemption is where we put in a device in a traffic signal that gives preference to the fire vehicles as they go through. I think we put a small amount in to try and every year add some to that system. I couldn't give you a status of where we're at, but that's what the fire preemption is for. There's probably some years we use it, some we don't.
If I could, in the spirit of trying to work things faster, I actually recognize, I guess, is this. I think we can, fire preemption, I'd almost like to substitute, put the bus shelters of $15,000 back in and take the reduction in the fire preemption. I recognize that bicycle master plan is really important and something that we're really committed to. I also recognize that we're doing a very, very significant investment in our bridge. That carries a lot of investment into bicycle transportation infrastructure. And so in that case, I'm kind of taking $50,000 out of bicycle master plan this year and over the next few years, but recognizing that we're putting, $17.5 million just for the trail portion on the bridge. So I'm not, it doesn't mean, by not allowing this $50,000 for it, doesn't mean I'm giving up on the infrastructure going in. So I'm just sort of leaning that that's the way I like to do. I mean, and I just know that bus shelters are a big deal to our residents, especially to the seniors. So anyway, that's just my feeling. I now put it back out to the floor. That was my turn to speak. Anybody else? Yeah, Alto?
So just to clarify, so I understand what I think you said, you're proposing like a 2A that
if
takes all
if
the things under reductions and puts them above in the place of the bicycle master plan?
No. If Councillor Helps's motion fails, then I would certainly welcome and entertain a different motion that says keep the bus shelters, reduce fire preemption, which is just the signalized system.
So they are
But you're keeping the master plan, the bicycle master plan?
Sorry.
I keep the reduction to the bus.
Point of order, aren't we, sorry, supposed to be speaking to the motion on the table, mm-hmm. not what we would do if this motion fails?
Thank you. Good one. To the motion on the table, please.
Okay.
All right.
Thank you. Good point of order. Councillor Alto has the floor, then we'll have Thornton Joe, and then we'll have Isaac.
Can I speak to the consequences?
Yeah, but not what you do if it fails.
Well, and talk about the consequences of it, because it affects the vote.
Can I ask a question?
Go for it.
Question of staff. If the items under reductions on this slide were not done this year, in your opinion, is this a catastrophic effect to our infrastructure?
No.
So we really should do these, but we could maybe put them off a year?
Right.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chairman and Joe. Thank you, Councilor Isaac.
So with Councilor Alto's question, and just making sure I understand Councilor Help's motion, so we would not do all under the reduction, and you want to add those back onto, okay.
Absolutely. That's the spirit of my motion.
With those numbers, not the
right. Top, not bottom.
Because those are reductions already, the additions.
So basically you have to get those back in, you have to take those out.
Right.
So it's a balance.
Yeah.
Right.
Councilor Isaac?
Yeah. I want to thank staff for bringing these forward. I think the reason we're discussing this now is because we weren't satisfied with the first reductions being proposed, so that's why I strongly support the motion. We flagged greenways, bus shelters, and cycling amenities as priorities to save them from the cuts, and Mr. Kalmanchek has presented alternatives and said that the sky won't fall in if we adopt the cuts listed below and protect the shelters and cycling, so I urge my colleagues to support Councilor Helps' motion.
I just have to say, I cannot support, I'll be voting against it, I cannot support reducing the storm drains mains replacement. I've been around this table far too many times to say those are cuts that just bite us usually at midnight on a Sunday. I just can't do it. So thank you on the main motion, although, so Councillor Mena?
Well, again, I think it's the order of magnitude, you know, just so that we're all clear in terms of what the original budget is and what remains. So we're not cutting them completely. We're cutting, what, 33 out of $740,000. So I just think we need to be clear about that. And the same thing with bus shelters. It says no reduction at 15. In fact, it was 25 originally. So I'm not feeling that they really all understand exactly what we're considering here, because you're adding them, but you're not adding them at the original amount. So it's percentages of them being cut, and I just think, do we clearly understand in looking at the spreadsheet what is left in those budgets? So with storm drains, it still leaves 707,000 if we reduce by 33. Mm-hmm. With bus shelters, it was 25, it leaves 15. So your concern is that 707 is not enough to handle the concerns and issues around the storm drain? I just want to be sure that we all are speaking the same concerns.
So it's one of the ones I just have a hard time supporting any reduction to maintenance on storm drains. Mm-hmm. It needs to be done, and it isn't like, that's just me. And and under this, we can still put in two bus shelters instead of five this year. Bus shelter being about $5,000. But I'm trying to save the bus shelters, what are we trying to do is say. I don't need the traffic signal so much as I need those bus shelters. But that's a different motion. That's a different idea. I think everybody's understanding that the bus shelters was originally budgeted at $25,000. Mm-hmm. The original recommendation was to reduce that by $15,000, leaving $10,000 in the budget. The motion on the floor says keep the budget at $25,000. The budget, the bicycle master plan was originally at $380,000. It's reduced $50,000, leaving $330,000 in the budget. The current motion on the table restores that $50,000 back to the budget, so it goes back up to 380,000. All these other ones, we'll see then. But you know what? I mean, and ultimately, that's why we have the rules of procedures. You call the question, you see where it goes, and if it doesn't work, you go to something else. If it works, away we go to the next one. All those in favor of approving option two, I think this is called, right? Which is option two, as is. So keep putting bus shelters and bicycle master plans back in, reducing all these other areas to counterbalance. All those in favor? One, two, three, four. This is going to be interesting. Opposed. One, two, three, four. Motion fails. Is that correct?
Yes.
On a tie vote?
Yep.
One, me, Madoff, Coleman, and Young. Okay. Motion fails. Council, I will entertain an alternate motion, please. Someone?
Oh, well, I'll put the mayor's motion with trading the bus shelters against the fire preemption. In support.
Okay.
I vote.
Thank you, Councilor Young. We've had a bit of discussion. So what we're doing is we're adding the bus shelters back. We're taking the fire preemption out. Everything else remains the same. In essence, the bicycle master plan remains reducing from 380 to 330. All of the other maintenance.
Can you go back to the other slide?
Is there another slide?
That one, yeah.
This one.
So can I ask a question? Just so I'm clear in my head. So you're saying that we keep the bus shelters, the top 15, we lose the bicycle master plan, and that means that we lose the fire preemption, but we keep everything underneath it. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay, I just want to be clear.
All those in favor of the question? Opposed? Isaac opposed. Thank you. Council, you're doing a really good job working us through this. Well done. Good work. What's next? Apprentice, you're going skunk eye down there. You got like one eye going sideways.
Are we perks or are we perks?
No, we're at the parks budget. Option one, option two, sort of. So this is the one, because it didn't, are we not ending up with a hybrid here between option one and option two?
Through you, Your Worship, you are fundamentally still eliminating $600,000 from the capital program. So it meets that the objective, the financial objective. What we have done is to try and address the concerns that were raised at your last meetings that we discussed this. And so money was put back into programs such as Greenways Plan, and we readjusted most of the program so that we can finish off some projects this year, accomplish some projects that are contemplated, and that we will then be working with a new base as we go through the 2013 program.
This is where I benefit from Councilor Mattis' earlier question, which is all peak about cutting play areas and amenity upgrades. Oh my God, children. And then realize, okay, you're recommending dropping $15,000 or $350,000. Okay, thank you. Councilor Young, Councilor Isaac, Councilor King, and as I saw. And
Beacon Hill Park's fairly straightforward, but you, what is it that you were gaining with the Greenways implementation? What are the consequences of losing the Pick West skate park rejuvenation? And could you highlight the other things we're trading off, the differences?
The Greenways plan to be bumped up to $353,000 allows us, as I mentioned earlier, to finish off the Cecilia Ravine Road Greenways project, and that was started late last fall and is still underway and will be completed in the next little bit. It also allows council to have enough funds in the project should they wish to proceed with Gonzales Chandler pathway this year. This is offset with things like eliminating the Big West State Park Rejuvenation Plan. It is a project that we had contemplated in terms of putting in some storage / program space. It has been contemplated and trying to get developed over the last number of years. We are nowhere near finishing that process, and I think it needs to be reviewed in the context of an overall master plan review of the park. And so that is being contemplated in the next couple of years. So that $35,000 is not necessary for 2012. The park management plan going to zero, what we're doing is building in now, and I think as I mentioned in my presentation on March 6th, was to say we will be doing planning 1 year for a particular park management plan, developing the implementation concept, and then doing the work the following year and planning the budget accordingly. So this year, there were funds that were carried forward every year for the next number of years. We've decided to build it into the program in a different way. Is there any? Those are the main things.
The hands I have are Young, Coleman, Isaac, now. Young's done? Yeah. Coleman's next. That's right.
I'll move option two. Adopt. Approval of option two.
I just wondered if you could speak in particular to the program of removing debris from the beaches and the impact that this reduction will have.
We initiated a project 2 years ago to look at Gonzales Beach and try and remove natural debris over the to try and minimize the amount of beach fires. Right. We've had great success over the past 2 years, and certainly last year experienced a very limited amount of debris found on the beach. What we thought we could do is, if we are finding that there is more to be removed, that we could incorporate that into a regular program through the operating budget, as opposed to having it a capital item.
Thank you. And Harbor Pathway is specific to Herring Cove. For no planning or design?
Yes, that amount is set aside to do a little bit of planning in and around the proposed bridgeway over Heron Cove, now that we've solidified some of the land opportunities in and around there.
Before I forget, I just want to place a market out there for Rivers, the council liaison for Mr. Gonzales. What just hit my mind is what a great opportunity for local volunteers to get in there and do the debris cleaning. There's the great Canadian shoreline cleanup that happens on an annual basis each year. And maybe it's something that if we cut this back, we can suggest to them that sounds like a really fun Saturday. Well, I mean, I've done it out in the board waterway a few times. But anyway, it might be a way to do it rather than, that sounds like one of those annual savings that we can find. Okay. Anything on the motion to do this one? Page 17, please. We're at 17. Is that page 17, please?
16.
I thought option two was on the table. So that's page 17? There we go. Summary. Any other questions on option two? All those in favor of picking option two? Any opposed? Dwayne was scratching his chin and going, Mr. Kalantrak's opposed. No, I want you to cut parks more. Spirit of collegiality down there, Mr. Kalantrak. Well done. Thank you. Where are we now? I think we've got our 3.25. I think we've got our options out there.
So we're here now on slide 20.
Yeah, we're on slide 20. Okay, thank you. So everybody, so recommendation one, so this is just an omnibus reaffirming what we've just done?
And this allows people to move forward, and we'll prepare the financial plan bylaws, basically.
Chair of the finance committee, please. Please move item number one.
So moved.
Although,
just a quick question.
Yes.
This, of course, reflects all of our changes today that goes down to 3.25?
Yes.
Thank you.
Councilor Isaac?
I can support this with huge reservations, principally the size of the police budget and the lack of more robust cuts, which over time I think needs to take the form of cuts to FTEs through attrition as crime rates continue to fall. And also I think we need to envision much greater cuts to our contracted services. And I think next year we have to realize much greater restraint in executive compensation, particularly to bring about parity, I think, between our QP benefit and wage increases and the greater increases enjoyed by exempt staff. But notwithstanding those reservations, in the interests of collegiality, I can support this motion.
All in favor of that motion? Opposed? Carried. Thank you. The capital budget is the next one. Now, we've argued over this one earlier.
All of the changes will be reflected in. So there will be a number of changes for the detailed draft capital plan that you have, the 20-year capital plan. So the decisions made to date, including today, will be reflected in the 20-year capital plan. There will also be rebudgets, things that a project.
Don't we print a lot of these, but we're going to dig into that really seriously. Mm-hmm. So,
Yes. And so, yes, that's great. But that's where it, so this approval in principle will allow us again to implement all of the changes that decisions have been made to date. And we will update the book because we actually, departments use that to manage. So we will.
Just a question, I don't know if this is appropriate or not, but is there some way you could highlight in yellow or red or something that will keep our attention? All of these things that we've approved, the reductions that are ongoing, can they be flagged, like not next year, but right in the documents so that we can see, be very aware of what we've cut and how we're going to get those things back?
Absolutely, we can do that. And I also highlight, bring them forward each time in terms of in slides, so in presentation. So we won't lose sight of those, but we could also highlight them in the capital plan.
That'd be great. I'm happy supporting a plan like that.
Thank you.
So moved.
Item number 2 is moved. All those in favor? Opposed? Carried. Preliminary direction and acceptable tax increase for this one. Now, this one's the rub. Because this is the one we always say, oh, look, it's 5%, but we don't really mean it.
It could be for give it to your priority setting.
I'd rather just maybe come up with a percentage, I don't know, 2.5%, just to put it in the record, or? Because if we are budgeting, our residents are going to have some expectations.
I don't know if we have a formal deferral motion. Deferral is a motion?
It's a postponement.
It's a postponement consideration motion?
Postponement to priorities.
I have a
Coleman,
question.
Coleman, Alto, you're on the floor. You had hands up. Let's go with whatever.
And I think there are lots of questions around it. I think trying to ad hoc an appropriate number at the moment. We know, we've said clearly that tax lifts have been too high. We know we're trying to drive them down. Setting an artificial 2.5 doesn't help me. At the moment, it's just an artificial number. I would rather we have some robust discussion, and I think that's why I won't do it at the moment, but I'd be happy to postpone it to the budgetary priority setting, because I think that that's where we do get into that meaningful. It might be lower, it might be a little bit higher. I think we're all trying to force it lower than 2.5, but let's have that discussion. I don't just want to pick a number now.
Councillor Baldwin, Councillor Helms.
Yeah, just to extending out on Councillor Coleman's comments. In going through the budget materials over the last couple of months this year, the beginning of my exercise in starting to cut things landed me in a place where I actually thought we could cut about $4 million out of the budget this year and go to 1.5. And then after I picked people up off the floor, I started to be a bit more inclined to look to a compromise in the sense of taking the steps that we need to take to get somewhere down that road. And I don't know if that's where we're going to end up, but I do recognize that what we've done today and in past weeks has certainly moved us far from 4.7 to 4 to 3.5 to now to 3.25. I think those are significant steps taken relatively quickly, which are definitely signaling to our residents that we understand their struggles and are trying to respond to them appropriately. I do think that there's probably a different number each one of us would pick around the table, and that it's important for us to have that discussion in a bigger context. I do believe that at some point we need to get somewhere that says, over 3 or 4 or 5 years, here is your maximum allowable lift, and then to allow the staff to come back with recommendations about how best to achieve that. But I'm not sure what that magic number is, and I suspect all of us have a different view of it, so I would prefer to defer it to have an opportunity to have that fulsome discussion in the context of what we've been saying about the direction we're going. I I think we're all fairly clear on the direction we're going, but I think we need more discussion on what those numbers actually are.
Councilor Helms.
Yeah, I just have a question of clarification. So if we defer the decision to what the tax lift is going to be to our priority setting session, does that mean that our five-year budget that we approved by bylaw on May 15th will show whatever randomly turns up? It's not a specific direction for council in terms of what we'd like to see, right? It's just whatever's going to be in there.
It would reflect much of what you've seen to date, which would be the based on 2% salary, 2% inflation, and the known collective bargaining. So that's what it would reflect. So it would reflect the status quo budget, based on decisions made today. So that would be reflected. Other than that, it would be status quo, no increase in services.
So what would it be like then? Because one of the things, I appreciate the desire, and we all probably have our own numbers around our head and in our heads and so on. I appreciate the desire to save this to our priority setting session. However, I also feel uncomfortable with saying, oh, here, public, here's a budget, but we don't really mean it. You know, and so what if we just said, I'm not making motions, I'm just thinking out loud. What if we said that we would like to see, and I want to know if this is a lot of work for you at this point, but no more than a 3.25 increase over the next five, so we're sticking to what we've come up with this year, so at least we're saying we're trying to hold the line. Now, we may get higher than that, we may get lower than that, but just as a signal that we're working where we are.
We can do that, and what I would do is we would arbitrarily reduce.
Sure.
And that's where we could say do it between the cities, say general government and the police. So we could make an arbitrary reduction, or we could just say reduced cuts. So it just reflects the bottom line as a 3.25%, because we won't be able to obviously.
Exactly. And so either we say, you know, let's just leave it at whatever it is and it's arbitrary, or we say let's make a motion to have it at 3.25 and it's still arbitrary, but at least we're executing some direction in the arbitrary nature of. So I guess I'm seeing some nodding.
It's very arbitrary.
So I'm seeing some nodding heads. I'll put a motion on the table that we hold the tax lift at 3.25% per year for the five-year plan.
I saw enough nods. Can I cut off the list?
Yep. That was my question. Per year.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried. Is any opposed there? Couldn't tell. None opposed. Good. Next steps?
Just done exactly what
we've done the next steps. We've seen all the timelines. We know when stuff's coming.
To the public.
Same bat channel, same bat time for GPC April 5th.
Yep.
Yes, ma'am.
Just one comment. In our last budget meeting, Dwayne commented about the asset management strategy, which engineering leads, by the way, and finance participates in, that we would be coming back to council in April. But Dwayne has an update in terms of timing, because I know council wants to know set timing of things. So Dwayne had leave.
So just an update is, we'll be to you in May. There's just some timing issues in getting the final strategy tied up. That additional time will also then give us time to focus on the direction for the next step, because this is just a framework, and there's quite a bit of work to do from the framework. So we'll be to you in May and give you a presentation on the framework and the next steps for the asset management strategy.
I'm sorry, I did want to add an in-camera item that we do need to add onto this agenda. So, thank you, Councilor. It wasn't there, I apologize, I forgot to pick it up, I picked it up halfway through. Councilor Eisen?
I'd like to thank Mr. Kalmachek for the update. My only reservation is if we get the report in the immediate wake of adopting our final 2012 budget bylaw, and if there's an extremely rude surprise in that report, rude, I don't want to use any connotations, but let's say council shocked and it's too late to make any final adjustments like we find out. I wonder if there's any way, maybe even in camera, if there's any way that perhaps council could see a draft version, just so we generally know the thrust of what the report's going to say, realizing there's still cleaning up to do and that staff, wouldn't be judgmental in terms of expecting a completely polished document. But I would feel comfort in consulting whatever version exists prior to final approval of the 2012 budget.
Mr. Callagher.
It's an overall strategy of how we're going to approach dealing with our asset and our asset classes and the evaluations. It certainly is going to be no surprise. It's talking about the process and the detailed work. So there's not going to be reports on different classes of assets. That's we're certainly not that detailed yet. So I don't anticipate any surprise. And as soon as we do have a final copy, we'll get it out to you as soon as we can. But there's just a number of issues with the consultant and focusing on that. So.
Thank you. There actually was an amended agenda. I just didn't have it in front of me, and I apologize for that. So with that, we need a motion to go in camera for labor relations issue, intergovernmental and labor relations.
So moved.
All those in favor? Opposed? Carried. Thank you. Thank you all. It'll probably be about 15 minutes, maybe less.